Orville said to me a few minutes ago. This is Orville Perry. He's a friend from somewhere to Roy.
Spruce Grove.
And Laurel Kemp from Spruce Grove. He said, are we having fun yet? All right, here we go. Can we have the first song? I know you've heard this song. I don't know if you know it. This little lady here, she's gonna be all the
Please.
Singing some old songs because we've been hearing this old story for a long time. How many of you have heard since you were a kid, Jesus is coming soon? So much sooner right now, right? Yeah. I was reading Thessalonians that he's going to come with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet, orgel. You got yours ready? Always. So we're just going to sing a few more. After I catch my breath, and you too. Lord, we thank you for this evening. Thank you for the blessed hope. The blessed hope that we have in Jesus our Lord. Oh, we thank you, Lord.
Yes.
We thank you that this is not all there is. We praise you. We ask you to be with us this evening.
Yes, Lord.
Have your way, speak to our hearts. We worship, may we sense a beautiful presence of Jesus right here in our midst. We thank you. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. And Pastor Gordon asked for this song, and you can't go to heaven unless you have a new name written down in glory, right?
Thank you.
verses. Pastor Gordon's been talking about what's going to happen when the Lord comes back. And we're going to change it to G, okay? And there's going to be chaos in this world. There's going to be all kinds of upheaval. There's going to be all kinds of stuff. And Gaither, who wrote that last song, wrote this, and he said, the marketplace is empty. No more traffic in the streets. All the builder's tools are silent. No more time to harvest wheat. How does the rest of it go? Nope. Busy housewives cease their labors. In the courtroom, no debate. Work on earth has been suspended. Why? Because the king comes through the gate. Let's sing it. We got three all verses here.
The marketplace is empty.
Yeah.
worship you, Lord. Let's just worship you, Lord. Glorious hope.
Hallelujah.
That we have.
Hallelujah. Come on, worship the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we worship you, oh God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise your name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Wow. I don't know if that don't get you ready for heaven. I don't know what does, right? I may just felt like you could just fly away.
There's a thought.
Whew, that was good leading. Thank you, wonderful band. Amen. Go ahead and give it up for them. I don't know if you've ever done this in church before, but we used to have a greeting time. COVID has kind of hindered that. But if you're comfortable, won't you shake somebody's hand or give them a fist pump or elbow pump or head pump? Or just say hi. I don't know about the rest of you, but I really missed the contact during COVID. You know, I mean, we couldn't hug. You know, we had one lady in our church in Dawson Creek. She was in her 90s, you know, and she had a ministry of hugging. I mean, she really did. We called her our church hugger. And COVID was really hard on her because she just wanted to hug everybody, you know. And of course, people, you know, don't hug me, don't hug me. And then we had to tell her, too, well, you know, we're not supposed to be hugging in the church. So she said, well, I'll go outside and hug them. And she did. She stepped outside, and she was out there in the cold hugging people. Wow. Don't you just love to be able to embrace one another?
Yes.
Amen. Greet one another with a holy kiss. Yes. We're maybe not quite there yet, but... It's still nice to shake hands and do something like that. I got, we had the list of the services. You know, Legacy Builders from now on is happening every Wednesday night. Well, not every Wednesday night. Sometimes we're going to be Wednesday morning. All right? But we're going every Wednesday. And because Prayer Summit is canceled till September, so we are just going right through. And we have a schedule back there. If you haven't got one, pick one up. But we have dinners at the last Wednesday of every month. So we have 11 o'clock service in the morning. And about noonish, we're going to have a nice luncheon. And about $12, our caterers were telling us. So if you'd like to sign up for that, we need to get numbers to our caterers. Marlene's back there. You can sign up your name. We have an Interact machine. You can pay with Interact, cash, check, Visa, MasterCard, American Express, Discovery, whatever, right? And that'll be good. And also next Wednesday, we're going to wrap up our series on heaven. And I'm just going to, how I'm going to do it, rather than just kind of preach a sermon, I want to answer a bunch of questions maybe we have about heaven. So I have about 20 already. But if you have a question about heaven, I have a little piece of paper like that in the back. It says, my question about heaven is, and just write it out there. If I don't have the answer, we got a lot of pastors in here that'll have the answer. If nothing else, we'll just make something up, all right? just kidding. But if you have a question, please fill that out. And then make sure you give it back to me by Sunday, all right? So don't bring it to me next Wednesday and expect me to give you an answer. Unless it's a really easy one. All right? So you can drop it off at the info desk, or you can drop it off. The best way is to drop it off tonight. So during the service, maybe you're thinking about a question. So at the back, just write it out, and then we'll try to answer as many as we can next week. By the way, there's a funeral on Saturday at 1 o'clock. Joseph Opeka, did I say that right? He passed away, and so it's at 1 o'clock at Springfield Funeral Home. So that's, he used to go to Ecclesia all the time. I remember him sitting at the back there where the controls were for the sound system. And so that is this Saturday. We've had a few people pass on just recently, haven't we? They're getting a head start to glory. You know, it's sad for us, but it's not sad for them. I mean, wow. Just think of what they're doing right now. I mean, I think about all the ones that I have a list in my office that I'm keeping of people that have passed on. You know, last year we had 12 people. At least most of them are seniors that passed on. And this year we're about 5 or 6, I think, at least, that have already passed on. And I'm thinking, boy, they're up in heaven having a great old time. You know, we're down here on earth and we're paying, you know, almost $2 a liter for gas. And we, you know, and they're having a lot of fun up there. So tonight, we are going to talk about end times. We got one more message. And then after that, I'm starting a new series. I call it my summer series. And we're going to be speaking on all through summer. The topic is going to be, I believe in miracles. Does anybody here believe in miracles? Am I amongst friends tonight? I believe in miracles. So we're going to talk about miracles, you know, different topics about miracles. And one of the things I really feel in my heart is that as we talk about miracles and I believe in miracles, let's believe for miracles. Can we do that? How many have seen a miracle in your life? Just raise your hand. Right, look around. Put your hand up high if you can. So look at it. People here have experienced miracles. So God does work miracles today. And we're going to talk about that. So I'm real excited. So that starts on June the 15th. Isn't it hard to believe we're already in June? June the 15th. I believe in miracles. Now, I've given it that title for a reason, because I wanted to constantly remind us that we believe in miracles. So tonight we are talking about end times, and before we start, let's open in prayer. So Father, we are so thankful for Jesus. We are so thankful for the hope that we have. Lord, that there's lots of things that are happening in the world, there's lots of troublesome things that are happening in the world, but Lord, we have such a wonderful hope, a hope in Jesus, a hope of heaven, hope of eternal life. And tonight, Lord, we just lift up those who are, Lord, amongst our church and outside of our church, Lord, who are going through difficult times right now. Lord, I know there are those who are dealing with cancer. And Lord, I've even talked to some of those this week. And Lord, there's others, Lord, that are dealing with various ailments and other infirmities. And Lord, tonight, we just lift them up before the throne room of grace. Thank you, Lord, that we do believe in miracles. And we know, God, that your word says there's nothing is impossible to him who believes. So tonight, Lord, we believe that you can work miracles in people's lives. And Lord, we pray for those who are grieving. Lord, we know that not only what happened in Texas, how horrible that was, but Lord, there's people that are grieving, even for in our church, Lord, who have lost loved ones. Lord, we just pray that you would be around them tonight with your comfort and your peace. Lord, I pray that you would just touch them tonight in the name of Jesus. Lord, may they just feel your presence. God, I thank you that we have such wonderful promises that we can stand on, the hope that you give us. So bless our service tonight, Lord. Minister to every person that's here, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen and amen. Welcome. So good to have you here. Amen. Do we need more chairs? This is the spitting zone, so you're in good place. Now I got you all worried, don't I? I try not to spit too much. But, you know, that's what it was years ago, right? The preacher didn't have a mic, and they just were shouting away, and you got spit on. A little bit of the glory. So we're really glad. We're glad to have all of you here tonight. So good to see you. And wasn't it a beautiful day today? Wow. You know, my wife and I walked here tonight, and I looked at the temperature, see how it's going to be cool when we go home. And I thought, no, it's still going to be like 21 degrees. So that's great. So we're talking about end times. And so again, my little chart up here, you know, we are right here somewhere. I believe we're almost on that line. This is the rapture. So we go up, Christians go up, and then we, you forgot to write down here. Maybe I forgot to tell you. Okay, what goes in here? Anybody know? Quiz time. Between the second coming and the rapture, what happens? Tribulation. Great tribulation. Not just tribulation, but great tribulation, right? Because how many know we got tribulation now? We have tribulations now. I mean, we do. I mean, so many things happening in our world. And Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble. And boy, is that ever true. So we are here somewhere, but at any moment, the trumpet's going to sound. The dead are going to rise first, and we that are alive will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. What a wonderful. So we are so close. We are so close. Great tribulation is going to happen. And then we have, of course, we talked about how we have the couple events here. We have the judgment seat of Christ, and we have the marriage supper of the Lamb, and then we have the second coming, and then we have the thousand-year reign or the millennium reign here that goes for 1,000 years. And so this is kind of where we're going to pick it up here tonight. And that we, after the millennium reign, my wife printed the devil up here. We, you know, trying to figure out what other name to give him. That's a good name to give him. Devil, Satan, accuser of the brethren. I mean, we've got a lot of names. A lot of names that he has in the Bible. You notice that? He has a lot of names. And I don't know any of them that are positive. I mean, they're all negative names because he's our adversary. Goes about like a roaring lion seeking those whom he may devour. Well, after the thousand-year reign, the devil is, and you know, there's the judgment of Satan, and I call it, there's a two-part judgment. At the beginning of the thousand-year reign, the scripture talks about that the first part of his judgment is that he's bound for 1,000 years in the bottomless pit, and there he is powerless, and he's sealed in this pit for 1,000 years. So somewhere right around here, he gets bound. And he's bound through this whole period of 1,000 years. And then the second part of his judgment, after the 1,000 year is done, he has this short season. And we don't know how long it is. The scripture, I don't know any scripture that tells us how long that is. But there is a season that he has where he goes out to deceive the nations again. And then after that short period of time, he will be forever cast into the lake of fire, where he will be tormented day and night forever and ever. And according to Revelation 20:10, he will be joined by the beast and the false prophet. And so it appears that their judgment goes on for all eternity. So that's what happens there. And then after that takes place, then we have the great white throne judgment. And I've always felt there's three judgments in the scripture. One is the judgment of seat of Christ, where believers will stand before the Lord. And the second judgment, I haven't really talked about this judgment, where the Lord talks about he'll separate the sheep from the goats. You know, there'll be the separation. I think that has a lot to do with Israel. But the third judgment is the great white throne judgment. There's probably not one of us in this room that haven't heard about the great white throne judgment. Even unbelievers, I think, have heard about the great white throne judgment. And this will be where the unsaved will gather before the Lord. Now, there's a scripture found in Philippians chapter 2, verse 10. It talks about that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I personally believe that's going to probably happen at the great white throne judgment. That's my own personal belief. That every knee, that's what the scripture says, that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Because there's a lot of people who have died who have not made that confession. But when they stand before the Lord at the great white throne judgment, they will be making that confession that their knees will bow, their tongues will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And again, that is my personal opinion. you're welcome to have a different one. And so this is not a judgment to determine if somebody will go to heaven. This judgment is all about people who have rejected Jesus, and they will receive the punishment that they have deserved. And so this final judgment is where we have the second resurrection. And the first one is at the rapture, where the dead in Christ will rise first and we who are alive will be caught up. So that's the first resurrection. This is the second resurrection. And so some verses, first off in Revelation chapter 20, verse 12 to 13, and it says, "And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead and that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he had done." There's at least four things that we can see from these verses. The first one is, everyone who didn't make the first resurrection will be at this one. You didn't make the first resurrection, you'll be at this one. And the scripture says that blessed are those, it says in Revelation 20, verse 6, blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection. Now, I really want to go by way of rapture myself. If I have to go by the way of the grave, I have to go by the way of the grave. But I really am looking at rapture myself. I have my hearing aids so I can hear the trumpet. So I want to go by rapture. Anybody here want to go by rapture? Wouldn't that be wonderful? Man, think about where you like to be when the rapture happens. Sitting at a table in a restaurant at the mall or something, or in a nice restaurant, just after you enjoyed the meal before you pay the bill. There's going to be something like that. Don't you think so? There are going to be people like that. So make sure when you order a big steak, you know, and just in case it happens there. But, you know, if you have not made the first resurrection, then you will be in the second resurrection. So again, the scripture says, blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection. And so the second thing I see there is a book of life. Now, Jesus talked about this. In fact, there's a lot of verses that I could give you tonight that talk about this. But Jesus, you remember in Luke chapter 10, where he sent his disciples out, you know, and to witness, and they were so excited, you know, they came back and they said, you know, even the demons were subject to us. You know, they were just so excited. And Jesus said this to them in Luke 10, 20. He says, "However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." You remember that song, "Is My Name Written There in the Lamb's?" Is my name written there? That's the greatest thing is to have your name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. I think probably all of you here tonight have your name written down. If you don't, make sure you take care of that, right? Take care of that. Get your name written down. And how do you do that? It's so simple. Even a child can do it. Just receive Jesus as your personal Savior. Ask him to forgive you and to come into your heart. And when you make that simple declaration, you get your name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's an amazing thought, isn't it? To have your name written down. And so that's what happens when we accept Jesus as our personal Savior. Our names get written down. And Revelation chapter 13, verse 8 says, "All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, and all whose names have not been written in the book of life belonging to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world." So that's a clear teaching in Scripture, you know, about having that book of life, having your name written down. The third observation I would make from those earlier verses is that everyone will be judged according to what they have done. Now, as believers, when we ask Jesus to forgive us, our sins are washed away. And they are removed as far as the east is from the west, never to be remembered against us again. So you think about all the things that you've ever done wrong, and probably some of us would want to think about those things that we've done wrong. You know, Linda and I, earlier on in our ministry, we had a jail ministry. And it was an exciting jail ministry. You know, we worked with misdemeanors and felonies. And there were some guys in there, gals, that had done some horrendous things. But, you know, the amazing thing was, when they asked Jesus Christ to come into their hearts, their slate was cleaned off. Not by the government, not by prison standards, but by his standards. Totally cleaned off. And you think about all that you've done. You know, before I came in here, when I came in here earlier today, you know, my whiteboard was all messed up. You know, there's youth here last night, I think, or kids here last night, and I don't know who else, but, you know, they're, you know, they like to, you know, Google, you know, doodle. Is that the word? You know, all over the board and stuff. And so I got my little, you know, stuff here. I have my eraser, and I erase it, but it doesn't clean it really well. And then I have these things here that really takes care of the whiteboard, cleans it right up. What a picture of our sin, you know. If we were to write down all of our sins here, and we wouldn't want to do that, but if we were, and we ask Jesus to forgive us, it is clean off completely. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Red like crimson? Oh, I lost you. What's that? Oh, like wolf, right. But I like that one, white as snow, don't you? Because I lived in the snow country, you know, and it was really ugly until it's, you know, the mud and stuff, you know. But then when it snowed, it looked so beautiful. You're constantly reminded of God's forgiveness because our lives were so messed up and, you know, and it's all the things that we've done wrong and all the mistakes we made. But when we ask Jesus to forgive us, it's washed as white as snow. It's amazing, isn't it? Because when people look at you and me, you know, especially the ones that know us, they remember the things that we've done wrong, you know. They remember, oh, yeah, I remember you used to be a drunk. You know, I remember you did this, and I remember you did that. But when you come to Jesus and ask him to forgive you, it is washed completely away. It is put in his sea of his forgetfulness. It is removed as far as the east is from the west. Aren't you glad he didn't say as far as the north is from the south? That's a measurable distance. The east and from the west is an immeasurable distance. In fact, you can travel east and you'll never stop traveling east. You'll never stop traveling east. So your sins, my sins, we are removed as far as the east is from the west. So when you and I ask Jesus to forgive us, the slate is clean. The blood washes us. It removes the sin. But for the unsaved that have not confessed their sins and asked Jesus to forgive them, when they stand before the Lord on that judgment day, every sin would be brought to the light. You know, there's times when I've, years ago when I used to, when I was the lead pastor and we had Sunday night service, you know, we used to call it evangelistic service and people bring their unsaved friends. And I remember, you know, we always preached an evangelistic, a salvation message and have people come down the altar, give their lives to Jesus. I don't know how many times saw that happen, saw some great things take place, but it was always amazing. And there was times where, you know, and maybe pastors in this room would remember, you know, when we give an altar call and we just really felt God was speaking to somebody, but they were just resistant. They were so resistant, you know. And you could just feel the conviction. You know, there was such strong conviction of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit was working. And we used to sing those choruses, you know, just as I am, you know, softly and tenderly, you know, Jesus is calling me. And I remember hearing the Kalapa brothers, you know, I don't know if you know the Kalapa brothers, but there's four brothers that are all, were preachers, but at one time, most of them were alcoholics. And I remember James Kalapa telling me the story, or his brother told the story. James was a pastor, and he told his brother, you better come to church tonight. So his brother George came, didn't want to go to church, but he came, sat on the, you know, front row, and James was leading the song, you know, about, what was that song? I think it was Just As I Am. And anyways, George was just kind of saying, okay, you know, they're wrapping this service up. You know, he had to sit through the whole message. He had to sit to the altar call, and while the song is being sung, just as I am, and he just was hanging on. You know, I'm not going to go up, I'm not going to go up. And after they sang the four or five verses, they sang it again. This is a true story. Sang all the verses again. And finally, George couldn't take it anymore, and he came down the altar and gave his heart to Jesus. And he became a powerful pastor, preacher, and evangelist. I had him speaking in churches where I pastored. I mean, but the conviction of the Holy Spirit, but you know, there's times I think people who have sat in the service, when they stand before the Lord, I wonder if God will not show them that picture of them sitting there. You had the opportunity. You know, my spirit was working in your life, and yet you rejected me. People will give an account. They will give an account. Every hidden sin will be brought to the light. There'll be nothing hidden in that day. Everything will be brought to the light of his judgment. So they will be judged by their works. And then the fourth observation there is the lake of fire. Those who are not found in the Lamb's Book of Life will be cast into the lake of fire. And so I don't have it written up here, but that'll happen right about here. The lake of fire takes place. And according to Revelation 19:20, the Antichrist and the beast are the first to be thrown into the lake of fire. And then in Revelation chapter 20, verse 10, the devil is thrown into the lake of fire after the 1,000 years. And then in Revelation 20, 14, death and Hades are thrown into the lake of fire. And then in Revelation 20, 15, those not found in the book of life are finally thrown as well into the lake of fire. Now, there are mixed views about the lake of fire. Some believe that the lake of fire, people will suffer for eternity. There's others that believe that when people are thrown into the lake of fire, that it'll be death for them. Again, there are different views. Revelation chapter 21 is an interesting view, scripture there. It talks about the second death. So I'm not going to argue one way or the other tonight. You can make up your own decision there. But I want to say one thing that is going to be horrible is eternally separated from God. Eternally separated from God. Our world has never been separated from God. God's presence has always been around. It's always there. His presence is here tonight. Aren't you glad? His presence is here. Can you imagine being separated from the presence of God? That would be hell itself, being separated from his presence. So the lake of fire is it. And then we get ushered in, and instead of saying heaven, I just put our forever. Then you notice the arrow, because it goes on and on and on and on and on and on. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, sing God's praise, and when we first begun. Can you imagine? I mean, how do you even imagine it? Revelation chapter 21 and 22 describes what I call our forever. Now, all my life, you know, Linda and I have both grown up in the church. We, you know, our parents were pastors and always involved in the church, you know. So at a very young age, you know, I found myself at the church. And, I mean, I had to be deathly sick to not be at church. You know, when Linda and I were sick in our home, our parents prayed for us and said, okay, we'll see you in church. I mean, I don't think I hardly missed church, you know. I mean, we were at church all the time. Not only Sunday morning, but Sunday school and Sunday night service and midweek. Some of you remember those, what's that? And youth and revivals every night. We were in church all the time. I have heard probably hundreds of messages about heaven. And I never get tired of it. Do you get tired of it? I never get tired of hearing about heaven. I have read many books about heaven. I got to tell you, there are some great books out there on heaven. I read books. I've heard sermons. We've sung lots of songs about heaven. One of the things that they say about new songs today, and I don't want to be critical about this, but there's not a lot of songs today about heaven, you know, for some reason. But our hymns, there's a lot of hymns that are about heaven, a lot of good hymns about heaven. And so And I've even heard about people who have died and brought back to life and talk about heaven. Wouldn't it have been wonderful to have that conversation with Lazarus? I mean, he was dead for 4 days. Okay, Lazarus, what happened? There's nothing recorded in Scripture, but wouldn't it have been wonderful to talk to him? Lazarus, what happened those 4 days? Someone said that, you know, he was in paradise, and that's why Jesus had to yell for him to come out, because he didn't want to come back. One thing for sure is that heaven is beyond our ability to comprehend. Would we all agree with that? It is beyond our ability to comprehend. In fact, I like this verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. However, as it is written, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. It goes beyond our imagination. It goes beyond our comprehension. We cannot even begin to imagine. And so, you know, when we talk about heaven, I always feel like I'm doing a lousy job. Because how do you describe and talk about heaven? Because it goes beyond our natural understanding, ability. How do we really grasp it? And beginning in Revelation chapter 21, we have a new heaven and an earth described. Now, some have said that this is just a makeover. I don't personally believe that. I believe when the Bible says that there's a new heaven and a new earth, it is exactly that. It is a new heaven and a new earth. The old has passed away. So, I mean, our earth right now is pretty beautiful. We haven't seen heaven, but our earth right now is, I would say it's very beautiful, wouldn't you? You know, Linda and I have lived in some very beautiful country. I mean, we haven't traveled like some, you know, Irv Cordes, you know, he's been, I think, in like 60, 70 countries, you know, so he's really traveled around. Some of you missionaries here have been in lots of different countries too. Everywhere I've gone, I've seen beauty. You know, when Linda and I pastored in Arizona and we had visitors from, you know, Vancouver Island come down and see us, they thought it was ugly. Oh, because it was all desert. But Linda and I found the beauty in the desert. I mean, there was beauty in the desert. You know, of course, we had the Grand Canyon in our backyard. I mean, it was fantastic. There was a lot of beauty in our world. But how do you describe the new earth? It's going to go way beyond what we have here now. And so anyways, Revelation 21:1 says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. And there was no longer any sea. I find it interesting that when we enter our new forever, one of the first things that we read that God does is he wipes away the tears from our eyes. You know, Revelation chapter 21, verse 4, it says, and he will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. I often wonder, again, this is my own, you know, personal belief opinion here. I often wonder that because of the great white throne judgment, we might know some people that are there. Quite possibly some family. I got some family right now that I don't know if they're going to make it unless, you know, they turn their life around. You as well, you have relatives there. Some of you have got maybe kids, siblings. You know, we got some people that we care about deeply. And we really believe and want to see them go to heaven. I mean, that is our desire. That is our prayer that they would make it. But the reality is people have a free choice. We have a free will. And we can, you know, choose if we're going to serve Jesus or not. So there will be those, I think, who will be at the great white throne judgment who will not make it. And I, you know, again, this is my personal opinion. I think there's going to be a lot of weeping, you know, maybe on our part, we're going to weep. And God's going to wipe away all the tears from their eyes. Somehow God is going to bring healing to us so that we don't go forever thinking about that. I really believe that somehow God is going to do that. Of course, God can do anything, right? And I believe that God will do that. And So that we can embrace our forever. I mean, how do you embrace your forever if you're haunted by the memories of something in the past? So I think we're going to be giving a clear mind, and so that's going to be all wiped away, the tears, and I think all those memories will be, you know, the bad memories will all be wiped away. And our broken hearts will be healed, and we'll be able to step into our new forever. Revelation 21 also describes the new Jerusalem. Again, our human minds cannot comprehend this stuff. You know, when you think about the new Jerusalem, again, I've read, you know, scriptures on this. I've read commentaries, you know, books on this. But it still boggles the mind. It's hard to figure it out because this city is really beyond description. It appears to be floating between heaven and earth. It has 12 gates and has 12 angels stationed at each gate. Each gate is made out of a pearl. Now, just think about that, you know. The things that we value today are part of the foundation and the part of the rock work, you know. I mean, the foundation is rare and precious stones. And the city appears to be a cube. You know, it's with equal length, height, and width. According to Revelation 21:16, when he measured it, he found it was a square, as wide as was long. In fact, its length and width and height were about, in the New Living Translation, 1,400 miles. Now, I got on my Google map to figure out what is 1,400 miles from Kelowna. Los Angeles. By way of road, not by way of air. It's quicker than that. But if you were to drive from Kelowna to Los Angeles, it's 1,400 miles. 2,250 kilometers or so. The New Jerusalem is that squared and cubed. Isn't that amazing? Now can your mind get around that? I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing. How many know that we're going to have a great time exploring heaven and earth? Now, it's going to be, wow, you know, some people, am I going to be bored when I get to heaven? You will not be bored. You will not be bored. I mean, you know, it's just amazing. And so, you know, to go 1,400 miles or 2,250 kilometers, it's a 24-hour drive, depending on how fast you drive, an 18-day walk, or a three-hour plane ride. I mean, so it's a huge city. I mean, there's no city on earth right now that can compare to this. You know, Los Angeles is a huge city. I mean, we've been to Los Angeles and New York. Those are huge cities in London. But it falls short of this. It's a huge. And the wall of this city is described as being 216 feet thick. 216 feet. Now, the present day Jerusalem wall thickness is 40 feet high and about 8 feet thick. So it just, there's no comparison. And the wall is made out of pure jasper. And the city is pure gold. How many like to think about walking on streets of gold, huh? Wow. It's like a clear glass. This Jerusalem will have no temple. Now, the old Jerusalem, you know, the third temple is yet to be built, you know, in the modern-day Jerusalem now. So there will be a temple there. But the new Jerusalem will not have a temple because the throne of God and the Lamb will be there. We won't need a temple. And there will be no light there either because he will be the light. Again, how do you imagine that? I mean, there is no such thing as darkness. There's no darkness because in him there is no darkness. It's just light, light. And so Revelation chapter 22 describes this river of life that flows from the throne of God and the Lamb. And on sides of the river is the tree of life, bearing 12 fruits and yielding its fruit each month. You thought the Okanagan was great. It'll be far, I mean, how do you even compare it? This fruit is going to be, I don't know what it's going to taste like, but I mean, I enjoy the fruit in the Okanagan, let me tell you. I love the cherries, you know, the apricots, you know, all the fruit. I mean, Linda and I, you know, we just really enjoyed last summer here. You know, we were out getting fruit, you know, and just enjoying the fruit of the Okanagan, and we can quite a bit, or she can quite a bit. I was her assistant. I carried the boxes into the house. But we, and so we still enjoy, you know, the canned stuff. I mean, the canned cherries, the canned apricots. And she, you know, one of the things that my wife said, I got to can more of that. That was so good. But imagine what it's going to be like, the fruit of heaven. This tree, it bearing 12 fruits, yielding its fruit each month. It's almost like the Garden of Eden is being recreated. Only this is far more superior. Far more superior. You know, the Garden of Eden had one problem. It had a serpent. This Garden of Eden will not, this paradise will not have any serpent. He is already taken care of. He is gone. He is history. He is history. And he knows his time is short. Let me tell you, the devil knows right now that his time is short. And I believe that's why, you know, we're seeing all the stuff we're seeing in our world today. He knows his time is short. He knows it's short. And one day we'll be forever, he'll be forever gone. So this new heaven and a new earth, there's going to be no more curse. There's going to be no more sin, no more sickness, no more getting old. Yay. No more getting out of our chair with moaning and groaning. That's the way I get out of my chair. My wife says, you look so stiff. I said, well, it takes me about 10 feet to get a little bit limber here. We will live in a perfect world. I mean, how do we even imagine that? We'll be living in a perfect world surrounded by his glorious presence. Surrounded by his glorious presence. You know, in the last chapter of Revelation, Revelation chapter 22, three times these words are repeated. And the words are by Jesus himself, I am coming quickly. Three times that is said. Now, when it's repeated, it's not a mistake. It's to show some emphasis on it, that I am coming quickly. And I believe that, you know, that that is the message that the Lord wants to give to the church today. I am coming quickly. His coming is sooner than we think. He is coming soon. He is coming quickly. And that's why we've got to be ready all the time. So next week, we're going to wrap it up. And again, I just want to encourage you, if you have a question, we'll be doing it as a question time next week. So if you have a question, I already have about 20 questions or so, but if you have a question, you know, I'd love to take a look at that and try to help answer that question. And again, there's a lot of things we don't understand about eternity, but there are some things that we can know from Scripture. And so I want to be able to share that next week. Well, I'm so glad about our future that we have. Why, aren't you? Man, people that have passed on, I think, wow, they're in a far better place. What are we going to do for eternity? Here's a question I'm going to answer for you right now. We're going to have a wonderful time just being in his presence. But we're going to also have a wonderful time being reunited with our loved ones. And I don't know about you, but I want to sit down and talk to some of those Bible characters. You know, I want to talk to Abraham, and I want to talk to, hopefully Solomon's there. I want to talk to the Apostle Paul. I want to talk to those guys. I mean, this could be so much. And we'll get to spend eternity together, too. That'll be wonderful. There'll be probably choirs in heaven. I don't know. I mean, we know in Revelation 5, there is a, you know, singing. So it's going to be glorious. Gord. So you got a song for us, brother? Why don't we stand?
Like a...